blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
The sorrows of death came about me, the pains of hell got hold upon me, and in my tribulation I made my prayer unto the Lord, and he regarded my supplication out of his holy temple. I will love thee, O Lord. The Lord is my stony rock, my fortress and my Savior. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The pains of hell cast hold upon me, and in my tribulation I made my prayer unto the Lord, and he regarded my supplication out of his holy temple.
Now and forever.
Amen.
Lord said to me, they have rightly said all that they have spoken. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren. And I will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak to them all that I command him. And whoever will not give heed to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I myself will require of him. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of the God, that same prophet shall die. The word of the Lord.
Thanks.
and his disciples went into Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and taught. And the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching. With authority he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord. They were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, and not as the scribes. From the pen of St. Mark, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
At the beginning of his ministry, the divinity of Jesus is again manifested to us, and the way that he speaks with authority, and in the way that he exercises that authority over the forces of darkness. First, notice how Jesus teaches with authority, not like the scribes. Well, how did the scribes teach? Well, as their name implies, they were charged to make copies of the Torah, the Bible. And that meant they became scholars and experts in what it said. If you have to copy down the same thing again and again, you become very familiar with it. But they went above and beyond as students of the Bible. So if you wanted to know what the Torah had to say something, they would be the expert that you would consult. And it was totally improper for a scribe in that role to teach on his own authority. Certainly they had their own opinions, but that wasn't their place. They would instead say, "It is written in the law of Moses or the Torah that such and such." And then they would expand on that by noting what other scriptures and prophets had to say about that passage, as well as what great rabbis had taught about that passage or that topic. But Jesus spoke very differently. As the living Word of God, he spoke on his own authority. "But I say to you," is how he taught. In fact, notice whenever he quoted the Bible, it was to strengthen the original meaning and to add further detail to help us keep the revealed word and will of God. Jesus did this several times, for example, in the Sermon on the Mount. "You have heard that it was said," in other words, it's written down in the Bible, in the Torah, in the Ten Commandments, "You shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, on my own authority, that everyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart." So what Jesus says is just as important, maybe even more important than anything that was ever said before. And so it's understandable. They were astonished at his teaching, not so much for the way, for what he taught, but the way he taught. He taught them as one who was speaking directly for God, not someone like a scribe who was quoting what God had already said. But one voice in the synagogue that day was less amazed than revolted. It was a man possessed by a demon who spoke through him, crying out in torment, "What have you to do with us, Jesus, Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? We know who you are, the Holy One of God." And immediately Jesus commanded. Again, authority. He commanded the demon to be silent and commanded him to leave. And it just happened. Like God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. Jesus said this, and it just happened as suddenly as he said it. Mark tells us they were all amazed. With authority, he commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. Twice Jesus spoke with authority, and twice they were amazed. And Jesus silenced the demon because he didn't wish that the truth should come from the same source from whence blasphemy and deception routinely flow. He doesn't want any confusion about this idea that Jesus has authority. His authority of the demons is stronger than the testimony of their words. The directions concerning exorcism from the Book of Occasional Services. Note, the practice of expelling evil spirits by means of prayer and set formulas derives its authority from the Lord himself, who identified these acts as signs of his messiahship. And so that affirms two things. First of all, that Jesus is the one who holds the authority to do this kind of thing. And second of all, he has handed that authority over to us to continue his work. Only the Messiah has the right to command the unclean spirits, and they will only be forced to obey when commanded by his divine authority. And thankfully, he entrusted that authority to his church so that we would not be helpless when he departed to return to heaven at the ascension. We could continue his work, and that in so many other ways, when he returned to the Father. You may recall that at the end of his earthly ministry, just before he gave us the Great Commission and ascended into heaven, Matthew tells us that Jesus came to the disciples and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." But he didn't leave us without a share in that power and authority. He gave us the authority to act in his name, to go out into the world and extend his invitation to others. As he said to so many, "Come, follow me." He left authority to his apostles to act in his name, in absolving sins, in the acts of binding and loosing, governing the church, and in celebrating the Eucharist and the other sacraments in remembrance of him. And Jesus gave us the power to accomplish his work through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, power and authority go together, but they're two slightly different things. Power is the ability to get something done, while authority is the right to do something. Jesus has both, and he shares both with us in his church. If you're still a little fuzzy on the distinction, picture a wedding reception. To say I have a kitchen and I have all the ingredients to make a fabulous wedding cake. So I bake a large cake and I bring it to the reception and I put it on the big table. I have the power to bake a cake, but not necessarily the right to bake the wedding cake. She hired somebody else to do that. I don't have the right because the bride didn't choose me. I'm not the baker that she wanted for this and gave that authority to. But suppose I am the baker that she hired to make the wedding cake. But suppose I have no kitchen and no ingredients. Then I would have all the authority, but none of the power. When Jesus teaches, and when he silences the demon and expels him in today's gospel, His power is demonstrated by exercising his authority, and his authority is manifested by the display of his power. Jesus has given us a tremendous gift, and with the gift, a tremendous responsibility, a gift of power and a gift of authority. He wants us to respect that power and authority ourselves by following our apostolic leaders in the church, recognizing their authority, their divine authority, given to them by Christ. And when they teach with the authority of Christ, and when we come to their ministrations, we are heeding Jesus' teachings and receiving Jesus' ministrations. You know, you don't see a whole lot of bumper stickers these days. In fact, the bumper itself has kind of disappeared into the car. But one of the few that are still out there is one that says, "Question authority." T-shirts, too. Some claim that statement, or that sentiment at least, goes back to Socrates. Most point to the more controversial psychologist Timothy Leary, who popularized the sentiment in the countercultural movement coming out of the 60s and the Vietnam War. Question authority. I don't think I've ever seen a bumper sticker that says submit to authority. But it certainly taps into that American independent spirit as well. We like being our own boss, and we don't like others telling us what to do. We don't want to recognize that they would have the right to tell us what to do. And moreover, the slogan, "Question Authority," also taps into that sinful, rebellious human nature, our fallen nature. Psalm 36 perhaps captures it best. There is a voice of rebellion deep in the heart of the wicked. There is no fear of God before their eyes. We may still cringe a little bit when we hear the words of Jesus saying, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore," that's the cringy part. It's not enough simply to acknowledge authority. To really acknowledge it is to put yourself under it. To follow Jesus means to call him Lord, and that means to submit to his reign and to his authority. It is to acknowledge his right to command and submit to his rule. To understand the written word, the Bible, is to stand under its authority. If we are to have a future in Christ, we must first repent of that rebellious spirit and come under his authority and receive the gift of his grace and forgiveness and mercy. In return, Christ welcomes us into the family of God, and being a part of that family entails responsibilities, which Jesus equips us to carry out. He did not leave us without a share in his power and his authority. He gave us the authority to go out there and continue to act in his name, to go into the world and extend his invitation to others to be a part of that kingdom. To, as Jesus said so many times to so many people, "Come follow me." And Jesus wants us who are called by his name to put to use that power and authority that he entrusted to all of us in the church. Like the early church in the book of Acts, we are to stay in Jerusalem no longer. The Holy Spirit has been poured out upon us, empowering us to be his witnesses. In Jerusalem, at home, in Judea and Samaria, a bit further out of our comfort zone, and finally to all the ends of the earth. We too might be astonished when we put to good use that power and authority that Christ entrusted to us as a gift. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty,
healthcare workers, especially Angie, Brian, Donna, Kimberly, and Perry. Let us pray to the time for self-examination and repentance, hence the symbols on the bulletin header, law, scripture, prayer, and penance. It's time to get ready to be shriven of your sins and to spend Lent doing your penance. We have some confession preparation guides for you in the narthex. If you don't have one, please take one. And know that I'm available to hear confessions every Saturday morning or otherwise by appointment. Sunday school, I looked this morning and I think I made a mistake and set the Sunday school lesson video to premiere on a different date. I'm not able to fix that from my phone, but I'll fix that as soon as I get home. So that will be available starting this afternoon on our website and Facebook page. The annual clergy retreat was this past week, and it was a refreshing time with the Lord and with brother clergy and our bishop. The rector of Christ Church in Plano was our retreat conductor, talking about clergy wellness. As president of the standing committee, Bishop Reed asked me to be the celebrant of the Wednesday Mass, and it was a great honor, especially because I don't think I've ever seen another simple priest be the celebrant at the retreat. Usually we've got, you know, at least three bishops on hand, so no priest gets the chance, so I was very honored to do so. Our financial secretary has giving statements for 2020 available for you in the narthex. Pastoral charge, examine your conscience, make a confession, and plan for your Lenten rule. For those joining us remotely, we are glad that you are here. We hope that you will tune in and join us again. If you're interested in joining us in person, come on down, and you can learn all about us at stfrancisdallas.org. We offer the Holy Sacrifice today for praise and glory of Almighty God, and thanksgiving for his many blessings, and with special intention for the people of the parish. I invite you to bring your intentions along with your hearts to present to God upon his holy altar today. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray.
It is a good thing to give thanks unto the Lord.
Thank you.
Pray, brethren, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive the sacrifice at our hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both of our and that of all the souls of the church.
Who receives the Lord to accept our prayers and our wishes, and wishes to pardon and bless, who now is blessed by that heavenly mystery. Through Jesus Christ, my Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with thee, and the liberty of the Holy Ghost, everyone and all.
Throughout all ages, world without end.
Amen.
in remembrance the blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. Rendering unto thee most proper thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we must humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless, and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and preachers of bread and wine, that we receive them according to thyself, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, making partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy father's goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee for that, that by the merits and death of my Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we in all thy whole church may obtain the remission of our sins and all the benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls, and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee. Humbly beseeching thee that we, Lord, who shall be partakers of this holy communion, may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. Remember also, O Lord, thy servants and handmaids who call before us, sealed with the seal of faith, and to serve the seal of peace. To them, O Lord, and to all that rest in Christ, we beseech that you grant the abode of oppression, light, and peace. For to us sinners also thy servants, who hope for the multitude of thy mercies, vouchsafe to grant us part and fellowship with thy holy apostles and martyrs, and with all thy saints, within whose fellowship we beseech thee to bear us. And although we are unworthy for our manifold sins, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our humble duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord. By whom, and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee. O Father, almighty world, without end.
Whoa.
speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you, and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Beginning of the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him. And the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.